Glorfindel was tall and straight. His hair was of shining gold, his face fair and young and fearless and full of joy. His eyes were bright and keen, and his voice like music. On his brow sat wisdom, and in his hand was strength.
One of the mighty of the firstborn, an elf lord of a house of princes, Glorfindel. This mysterious figure is the next character I will discuss in my series of videos dedicated to heroism throughout the ages of Middle-earth. Once again, I will give a brief background of this figure before discussing an act of heroism, bravery, or courage, showing why Glorfindel deserves to be mentioned alongside other heroes of the Legendarium. Before discussing the act itself, let's give an overview of Glorfindel. His name is said to mean golden hair or golden-haired elf. His history is mostly centered around discussions related to Tolkien's use of the name Glorfindel, with a character called Glorfindel appearing in early versions of the Legendarium in the Fall of Gondolin tale, and another appearing much later in the Lord of the Rings in the home of Elrond, Rivendell. The reuse of a name causing issues for Tolkien. Christopher Tolkien clears up the confusion in the last writings of his father from the Peoples of Middle-earth, where it is made clear that Glorfindel of Rivendell in The Lord of the Rings was not originally thought of as the same figure as Glorfindel of Gondolin. A random use of a name escaping reconsideration in final published form. Tolkien went as far as to fix the problem by combining the two through the act of Glorfindel of Gondolin's death and re-embodiment, having him return to Middle-earth and be the figure we witness in Elrond's household. This adds to the intrigue of Glorfindel, his fall and return. It also leaves me with little to discuss in terms of family history. We do not know when exactly Glorfindel was born, who his parents were, if he had siblings, if he had a wife or children. Even his position as Lord of the House of the Golden Flower, one of the 12 houses of Gondolin, is only really referenced in earlier versions of Tolkien's tales, specifically the Book of Lost Tales, or Cuenta Noldorinua, both discussed in the Book of Lost Tales and the Shaping of Middle-earth volumes of the History of Middle-earth, respectively. What we do know from the brief writings of his early history is that Glorfindel was born in Valinor sometime during the Years of the Trees. He took part in the flight of the Noldor, their exile to seek vengeance against the fallen Valar, Morgoth, following the murder of Fëanor's father, Finwë, and the theft of the Silmarils. His relationship with Turgon meant that despite his reluctance, Glorfindel left with him, but did not take part in the treacherous kinslaying of Alqualondë, Tolkien making it clear that this was a figure of honour, nobility, and potent spiritual strength, as we later witness.
There was a dreadful pass. Kirithoronath it was named, the Eagle's Cleft, where beneath the shadow of the highest peaks a narrow path wound its way. On the right hand it was walled by a precipice, and on the left a dreadful fall leapt into emptiness. Along that narrow way their march was strung, when they were ambushed by orcs, for Morgoth had sent watchers all about the encircling hills, and a Balrog was with them. Then dreadful was their plight, and hardly would they have been saved by the valor of yellow-haired Glorfindel, chief of the House of the Golden Flower of Gondolin, had not the Rondor come timely to their aid. Many other songs that had been sung of the duel of Glorfindel with the Balrog upon a pinnacle of rock in that high place, and both fell to ruin in the abyss. Then Thorondor bore up Glorfindel's body out of the abyss, and they buried him in a mound of stones beside the pass. And a green turf came there, and yellow flowers bloomed upon it amid the barrenness of stone, until the world was changed.
The fall of Gondolin was changed many times throughout different versions. It was, after all, the earliest of stories in the legendarium. But it is told that Maeglin, nephew of King Turgon of Gondolin, was captured by the Dark Lord Morgoth and gave up the secret of the Hidden City, a place Morgoth had long sought to find. Maeglin was released in order to betray Turgon further and aid Morgoth. As the city was attacked by the forces of Morgoth, including Balrogs, dragons, and orcs, Maeglin betrayed Turgon by convincing him not to assault those assaulting the city, and by spreading false messages in order to keep reinforcements from protecting areas of the city. Glorfindel was not the only hero in the Fall of Gondolin, but his courage in standing against a Balrog of Morgoth in order to protect those escaping the siege is certainly worthy of the term heroic. Alone he stood against the Demon of Might, and he died with it as they both fell into the abyss. The exiles of Gondolin, led by Tuor and Idril, were able to survive due to his noble deed, an act that changed the events of the First Age and beyond. Not only did Tuor and Idril survive, but their son Erendil survived, carried on the shoulders of the servant Hendor, Erendil playing a vital role in his plea to the Valar on behalf of both elves and men, leading to the downfall of Morgoth in the War of Wrath. Glorfindel was slain, and his spirit was obliged to return to the Blessed Realm, following the laws established by Eru. The spirit is willed to return, to remain in the halls of waiting until the King of the Valar, Manwë, grants release, in conjunction with the Doomsman, Namo. Death through injury that is too great to heal physically would cause disembodiment of the spirit, and this was considered grievous and unnatural. It was then the duty of the Valar to restore elves to incarnate life, if the elf desired it. If the elf had performed evil deeds or refused any repentance, this process could be delayed, and if the spirit harboured malice against the living. Glorfindel bore no such malice. He sacrificed himself for others without even realising the importance of his sacrifice. He would still defend them, regardless of their importance or rank. This action of Glorfindel was important in accomplishing the designs of the Valar. He was purged of any guilt in the rebellion of the Noldor, for which he had very little to blame, and was released from Mandos, incarnated once again. He was now free to dwell in the Blessed Realm, after regaining a primitive innocence and grace that the Eldar inherently possess when they first enter the world. His spiritual power, as Tolkien puts it, had grown to immense proportions through his deeds in life and his sacrifice, that he was now considered an equal to many of the Maiar, those servants of the Valar. It is then guessed that Glorfindel returned to Middle-earth as an emissary of the Valar in the Second Age, before the changing of the world and the drowning of Numenor. That change meaning no embodied creature of humane or lesser kinds could return from the Blessed Realm, which had been removed. His arrival would strengthen resistance against Sauron, aiding leaders such as Gil-galad and Elrond. If the Istari are said to be emissaries ushering in the Age of Men through the downfall of Sauron, I like to think of Glorfindel as an emissary sent to aid the elves, and their inevitable departure from Middle-earth. There is little I have to say about the importance of Glorfindel's stand against the Balrog, or just what makes it heroic. The fact his stay in Mandos was brief shows the character of Glorfindel, the selflessness, the willingness to put himself on the line against a terrible power in order to give those unable to fight a chance to escape. Not only does Glorfindel fit the definition of a heroic warrior, one able to hold a weapon against evil and stand his ground, he holds the qualities of a hero in his very nature, growing in stature spiritually, becoming an emissary of the Valar, a position only shared by spirits who entered the world at its making. His sacrifice to help others is echoed in the Third Age, when Gandalf confronts Durin's Bane. And much like in that confrontation, the sacrifice was made without realizing the importance of the sacrifice. This is what makes these moments courageous. And this is what makes Glorfindel more than worthy of being called a hero of the First Age. What do you think of Glorfindel as a figure? Was he underused in The Lord of the Rings? Or did he play a part that is unspoken? Let me know if you would like a future video about Glorfindel, perhaps talking about just why he was sent back to Middle-earth. I hope you enjoyed this latest video in the Tolkien lore series. In the next Heroes video, I will talk about a heroic journey into a dark land that healed old wounds. Thanks for watching, and I hope you will leave your thoughts in the comments, and subscribe if you are new to the channel.